joined now by Damian Hinds, the Home Office Minister in charge of our security and borders. Clearly, what we've been reporting this morning, Mr. Hinds, is very concerning. Once again, we have small, fragile craft in the middle of the channel, people who are at real risk and danger. And what's the plan? What's the strategy? How can we stop this flow of people coming over the sea from France?
Yeah, good morning, Ed. And you're quite right. It is a terrible situation and people's lives are being put in danger. These are immensely perilous journeys run often by sophisticated, organised crime gangs. It's a multinational operation and we have to disrupt it and prevent these terrible risks being taken. And our cooperation with the French, I mean, as your discussion just then highlighted, our cooperation with French authorities is absolutely fundamental to that for obvious reasons. It was a good conversation yesterday, productive, with the French Minister Damian and the Home Secretary, reaffirming commitment, and we really welcome the French commitment on this to up the effort further and to stop all of these crossings taking place.
Are the French actually really cooperating, though? I know the British government gave the French £54 million to strengthen their borders, but are they spending the money? I mean, I know we've paid for drones to help them monitor what's happening. Are those drones actually in use at the moment? Are they using the money we've given them?
Yeah, we have provided funding, and they are using the funding, and we continue to work cooperatively.
Look, so I mean,
thousands. It is important to say thousands of these very dangerous journeys have been stopped, but we need to go further. And that was the essence of the conversation, the meeting yesterday with the Home Secretary and the Minister from France to see what more needs to be done. It's a complex piece of coastline, as you know. I mean, you mentioned that you yourself have been sailing in the Channel. You'll know that piece of French and indeed Belgian coast is complex with many, many different leaving points. It's hard to police, but it's incredibly important that it is, you know, effectively monitored and policed. And as I say, you know, we need to up those efforts. And I really welcome the French commitment to work with us on that.
I guess my worry at the moment is who's actually in charge of this relationship with the French and our borders? Because you've got Lord Frost, who's dealing with the Northern Ireland Protocol, disputes with the French over fishing, and it feels as though things are quite antagonistic. And yet, as far as I can see, being furious with the French, the Home Secretary does quite a lot of being furious, doesn't seem to actually work very well. Don't you need cooperation with our neighbour rather than the rows which we seem to be mired in at the moment? Isn't it a time for some diplomacy?
So, I mean, look, after the Republic of Ireland, France is our nearest European neighbour, and they're an incredibly important partner to us, and we do work cooperatively and have a great relationship. Sometimes you also have to have difficult conversations, and that's true sometimes of friends as well. But we have a lot of shared interests, and we need to make sure we optimise our work together, including this really important area of stopping these dangerous crossings that are putting people's lives at risk for the profit of organised immigration crime.
Damian Hinds, we've just seen the terror threat level raised that will cause an enormous amount of alarm amongst people. What do we know about the origins of the man responsible for the attack on Sunday?
Yes, Susanna, as you say, the threat level has been raised from substantial to severe. It had been at substantial for quite a while, meaning an attack is likely, and severe means an attack is highly likely. I'm afraid there are always people who are seeking to do us harm, and our security service and law enforcement work night and day to protect us. Actually, there've been 31 late stage plots disrupted in the last few years since 2017. But we need to be ever vigilant. We talk about asking people to be alert rather than alarmed. It's not about changing our daily lives, but it is about, as you say rightly, it's about that heightened vigilance. Obviously, anybody with information about this incident, please be in touch with Northwest Merseyside and police, or you can always contact Crime Stoppers anonymously. But also more broadly, if people are suspicious of something, if something doesn't look right please be in touch, because you know, law enforcement relies on everybody's vigilance to support them in their work.
Was he being watched or monitored? Were the concerns raised about him? We know that the Christian couple who took him in when he was homeless, and he was living with them when he was baptised at Liverpool's Anglican Cathedral. I mean, they're devastated by what has happened. But they said that they thought he'd suffered some mental health problems, spent some time in hospital. It was the only time they'd had a run-in with him. They think something happened between that time, obviously, and now, which led him to do what he did. What sort of monitoring was he under?
So, Susanna, as you know, the deceased individual has been named by police, and the other four people who were arrested, the police have been satisfied with their account, and they've been released. While there is a live investigation going on, I know you'll appreciate that the police, they need the time and the space to do that investigation. It wouldn't be right for me to comment on background and on some of the stories we've been hearing. But on the more general points about preventative services and support services, you know, our work on prevent is incredibly important. Huge numbers of people who one might look at. I'm afraid that, you know, the reality is that you can't always be pinpoint accurate. But you know, the services strive to do that as much as possible and put in place the support for individuals and to identify individuals who might be a risk. And on the other point you made, and again, I'm not drawing specific inferences, but on mental health, yes, of course, we recognise that there are often links between mental health issues and in individuals and some of these very dark, very dark routes that people go down. Obviously, the vast majority of people with mental health issues, that doesn't become a problem, but in a small minority of cases, it does. And that, of course, is something we have to be constantly working on too.
Thank you, Minister. Important advice there about the key need for us all to be vigilant.